Heather Marie Sturr is an associate professor of history at the University of Southern Mississippi and a fellow in the Dale Center for the Study of War and Society. She is the author of Beyond Combat, Women and Gender in the Vietnam War Era, which was published by Cambridge University Press in 2011. She is also co-editor of the forthcoming anthology, Integrating the U.S. Military, Race, Gender, and Sexuality Since World War II, which will be published by Johns Hopkins Press this spring. That would be like next week or?
Next month.
Next month.
Which
next
I guess
month.
Is next week.
Okay. Next, okay. Yeah. Dr. Sturr is currently writing two other books, Saigon at War, The Third Force, and The Global 60s in South Vietnam, which will be Cambridge University Press, and Reflecting America, U.S. Military Expansion and Global Interventions from Prager ABC Clio coming up. In 2013-2014, Dr. Sturr was a Fulbright Scholar in Vietnam, where she was a visiting professor in the Faculty of International Relations at the University of Social Sciences and Humanities in Ho Chi Minh City. Dr. Sturr's articles have appeared in the New York Times, National Interest, as well as numerous blogs, academic journals, and anthologies. And it is a great pleasure that I introduce Heather Sturr. Thanks.
Well, good morning, everyone. I just want to say thank you to Michael Noonan for inviting me, and thank you to everyone from FPRI, especially Rachel Hemler, for all of her help making our arrangements. I also want to thank Paul Herbert and everyone here at the First Division Museum. This is such a fantastic space, and I'm really excited about the museum renovation. And then I also want to thank all of you for being here. So why did the U.S. go to war in Vietnam? This is a question that historians are still debating. And one of the reasons why we're still debating this question is that it's hard to say exactly when the U.S. war in Vietnam began. Do we date it back to the 1940s and look at decisions made by President Truman and his administration to help fund the French efforts to recolonize Vietnam? Do we trace it back to the 1950s? And President Eisenhower, and where he also authorized the continued funding of the French war effort in Vietnam, and then after that war ended, when Vietnam was partitioned, authorized U.S. aid and support for establishing a non-communist nation in the Republic of Vietnam, or South Vietnam, as a counter to the Communist Democratic Republic of Vietnam, or North Vietnam. And I'm going to refer to these two countries as South Vietnam and North Vietnam, just for ease of understanding and keeping track. President Eisenhower, as we know, was motivated by the idea of the domino theory, that if one country in Southeast Asia falls to the communists, then all of the rest of them will begin falling, and there will be a ripple effect felt throughout the Asia-Pacific world. And this is really the guiding principle regarding U.S. policy in Vietnam from Eisenhower through President Johnson. Do we trace the start of the U.S. war in Vietnam back to the early 1960s with President Kennedy and his focus on anti-communist nation building and the increase in U.S. political and military advisors in South Vietnam? Or do we trace it back to 1964-65 and President Johnson and his decisions regarding escalating the war? Do we trace it back to the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution in 1964, where Congress authorized President Johnson to use military force in Vietnam without formally declaring war, in Marines landing in Da Nang in 1965, do we trace it back to that moment? Rather than looking at one starting point, let's think about U.S. intervention in Vietnam as a gradual process that involved economic aid, political and military advisors, and military force. So the moments that I mentioned are all different moments, and they come with different contexts. But there were three unifying factors, or three threads that unified all of the moments that I mentioned. And this is what I'm going to focus on in the talk, these three factors or these three threads. The first is communism, and especially regional concerns in Southeast Asia about communism. The regional approach to understanding U.S. intervention in Vietnam is important because U.S.-Vietnam relations and the Vietnam War didn't develop in a vacuum. So it's important to understand the regional Southeast Asia context for what's going on, what the concerns were about the spread of communism in the region. The second unifying thread is the Cold War. And here I'm referring to superpower tensions, big power tensions between the U.S., the Soviet Union, and China. In what ways did those tensions shape U.S. intervention in Vietnam in all of those moments that I mentioned? So big power tensions, superpower tensions in terms of the Cold War. We want to acknowledge what's going on and explore what's going on in Southeast Asia, but we can't dismiss the fact that superpower decision-making and tensions mattered to American decision-making regarding military intervention and war in Vietnam. And then the third unifying thread that brings together all of these moments of gradual intervention in Vietnam is credibility. Credibility. Presidents from Truman through Johnson worried about American credibility. I'm going to give you just two examples of that, and then I'm going to talk about more later as I move in and get more in-depth in these unifying threads. So in March of 1965, Assistant Secretary of Defense John McNaughton emphasized credibility as the most important of several U.S. objectives in Vietnam. And then in a speech in April of 1965, President Johnson stressed America's role as a guarantor of freedom in the world. And this is a quote from Johnson from this speech in April of 65. Around the globe, from Berlin to Thailand, are people whose well-being rests in part on the belief that they can count on us if they are attacked. To leave Vietnam to its fate would shake the confidence of all these people in the value of America's commitment, the value of America's word. Bill talked about value, protecting American values in his talk yesterday, and we see that when American presidents, policymakers, and diplomats are talking about U.S. credibility in the world. So credibility is that kind of third unifying factor that brings together all of these moments of gradual intervention in Vietnam. And there are others, and again, I'll talk about some others as I move forward through this. All of these unifying factors were themselves intertwined and linked. So we know the ideological battle between communism and democratic capitalism was in the central battles of the Cold War, bringing together those threads. And then, as I mentioned, Cold War era U.S. policymakers, diplomats, presidents from Truman through Johnson argued that the U.S. had to prove its commitment to containing communism and supporting democratic nation building. Otherwise, it would lose international credibility. This is, again, concern from the 40s through the mid-60s. And so now I'm going to go a little bit deeper into these three unifying threads so that we could see specifically how they shaped U.S. decisions to go to war in Vietnam. So the regional concerns about the spread of communism in Vietnam. So just some maps to orient ourselves in looking at Southeast Asia. Because again, as I said, U.S.-Vietnam relations and the Vietnam War didn't happen in a vacuum. And that's something that I think is important to remind ourselves. We're teaching U.S. survey, and we're talking about bringing in the Vietnam War. I know that I fall into this trap of thinking about the Vietnam War as an American thing. But it's important to think about that regional context because U.S. alliances in Southeast Asia did have an impact on American decision-making regarding military action in Vietnam. One of the things that's important to think about in terms of the regional context is decolonization. So as we know, after World War II, European colonial empires in Africa and Asia were crumbling. Europe had been destroyed by the war. European countries were trying to rebuild, and they couldn't afford to hang on to their colonies anymore. In the colonies, anti-colonial activists saw opportunities to establish independence. They were people inspired by the ideas of freedom and self-determination. So they saw opportunities to fight politically and militarily for independence in the wake of World War II. From the perspective of the Cold War superpowers, all of these new countries are potential allies. Okay, all of these new countries are potential allies. And the U.S., the Soviet Union, China, they all wanted to get as many countries as possible into their orbit. So it mattered whether these new countries adopted communist or non-communist governments. This is opportunities for alliance building in the wake of World War II. And Vietnam is an example of this. So Vietnam had been a colony of France since the 19th century, fell under Japanese control during World War II. In September of 1945, Ho Chi Minh declared Vietnam's independence. Now, Ho Chi Minh was a nationalist, but Ho Chi Minh was also a communist. And that's some important context that the historical scholarship, writings on the Vietnam War, really until recently, has kind of obscured. The talk of Ho Chi Minh is a nationalist, and that's true. He wants to establish an independent Vietnam out of colonialism. But Ho Chi Minh was also a communist, and he was very well connected in international communist circles. He was involved in the establishment of the French Communist Party in 1920. He spent time in China and in the Soviet Union in the 20s. So we have to remember that while he's talking about nationalism, he also is very well connected in international communist circles, and he himself was a communist. And the idea of a communist Vietnam was alarming to non-communist governments and movements in Southeast Asia. And this is another thing that I talk about with my students a lot and try to kind of drive home the fear. And this idea of fear, again, I think this came up in Bill's talk. Paul mentioned it in his talk about the museum yesterday. This idea of fear that, and especially when you're talking about communism and responses to communism in the U.S. and show the duck and cover videos and some of those things, that to students now, that can almost seem kind of silly, although I do think kind of growing up with the global war on terror has maybe made them a little bit more empathetic to that feeling than students maybe who were born earlier. But if we think about the context of the time, no one knew what actually was going to happen. And so if we think about the context of the time, we can understand why in Southeast Asia, non-communist governments and movements were alarmed by the possibility of, for example, South Vietnam becoming communist, all of Vietnam becoming communist. There were tensions and conflicts between communist and non-communist movements and governments elsewhere in Southeast Asia, in Malaysia, in Indonesia, in Thailand, in the Philippines, after World War II. When Vietnam was partitioned and the Republic of Vietnam, South Vietnam, was created as a nation, those governments and movements supported South Vietnam and saw it as a crucial bulwark against the spread of communism in Southeast Asia. 1954 was actually a big year in developments in Southeast Asia. So in addition to the partition of Vietnam, also in 1954, the Asian People's Anti-Communist League was founded. Asian People's Anti-Communist League was founded to resist communist insurgencies. So this included representatives from Southeast Asian countries as well as Taiwan and South Korea. And the group turned its attention to Vietnam. Beginning in 1964, the theme of the APACL's annual meeting was what to do about South Vietnam, how to provide assistance to South Vietnam, how to assist South Vietnam's military. At the 1964 meeting in Taipei, the annual meeting in Taipei, the delegates of the group decided to open an APACL office in Saigon for the purpose of demonstrating that interest in helping to support the Saigon government. Newspapers in Bangkok, Kuala Lumpur, Manila published editorials supporting South Vietnam. So there is regional support in Southeast Asia for South Vietnam, which shapes the thinking of American policymakers regarding military intervention. Also in 1954, the Southeast Asian Treaty Organization was founded, CEDAW. And this is also important to our understanding of the regional conditions that shaped U.S. intervention in Vietnam. Members of CEDAW were the U.S., the Philippines, Thailand, Britain, France, Australia, New Zealand, and Pakistan. So giving you those lists of names, you see there's actually only two countries in that group that are in Southeast Asia. The others had interests in the region. Purpose of CEDAW was to prevent communism from gaining ground in Southeast Asia. So again, 1954 is a big year in terms of understanding the regional context that shaped U.S. military intervention in Vietnam. So the purpose of CEDAW, prevent communism from gaining ground in Southeast Asia. The U.S. used membership in CEDAW to refuse to participate or to support the election in 1956 that was meant to unify North and South Vietnam. American intelligence agents, diplomats, believed that Ho Chi Minh would win that election by a margin so large that they suspected that an election would be rigged and that he would win in a rigged election. And so the U.S. policymakers used membership in CEDAW. The point of CEDAW is to prevent communist expansion in Southeast Asia. Membership in CEDAW to justify a refusal to participate in that election. Say, as part of our commitment to this treaty organization, we are preventing communism from gaining ground in Vietnam. We believe that this is what's going to happen, and so we have to prevent South Vietnam from going communist. CETO provided a legal framework in the minds of some American policymakers for continued U.S. involvement in South Vietnam. So in addition to regional concerns, broader tensions between Cold War superpowers, so moving into that second unifying thread, broader tensions between Cold War superpowers also shaped U.S. decisions regarding military intervention in Vietnam. As I said earlier, the U.S., the Soviet Union, and China are all vying for alliances with newly independent countries. And all three of these countries are actively involved in courting and helping to develop newly independent nations so that they can get them into their respective orbits. In the case of Vietnam, as the U.S. is giving aid and development assistance to South Vietnam, the Soviet Union and China are giving economic, military, and development aid to North Vietnam. So Vietnam becomes this kind of proving ground where all three of these countries are trying to make their mark. Now, Hanoi knew that it had to be careful in its dealings with the Soviet Union and China because of tensions between those two countries. This gets to be a very complicated international mix. North Vietnam knew that it benefited from both countries. It definitely benefited from access to the Soviet sphere, trade with Eastern Europe. And all of these interplays and all of these issues affected U.S. thoughts about intervening in South Vietnam and continued support for South Vietnam. And so the Cold War power struggle between superpowers, between the big powers, was key in shaping U.S. military intervention in the Vietnam War. Now, the U.S. is dealing with these international contexts, the U.S. is dealing with the regional context, and the U.S. is also thinking about American credibility. So the third unifying thread that brings together all of these moments that lead to a gradual, or that constitute a gradual U.S. intervention in Vietnam. Credibility. Demonstrating American resolve, American commitment to what the U.S. is saying in the world about its commitment to preventing the spread of communism in Southeast Asia. That the U.S. will put talk into action. So presidents from Truman through Johnson, we're talking about credibility. We're worried about American credibility. So I'll just give you a couple of examples of how this plays out. So Truman, during his administration, the State Department issued NSC 68. This came up yesterday in one of the talks as well. NSC 68, a paper arguing that the U.S. must embark on a massive buildup of conventional and nuclear weapons to contain communism. This is a way for the U.S. to show that it is tough on communism. NSC 68 is 1950, contain communism. During the Eisenhower administration, President Eisenhower considered a U.S. military action, possibly even using nuclear weapons, to aid France at Dien Bien Phu in May of 1954. Well, Truman was up against this is a one-party rule. I was listening to CNN coverage of the healthcare bill today, talking about some of the difficulties in one-party rule, and I thought about Eisenhower, a Republican president, who had a fiscally conservative Republican Congress that was not willing to allow for a U.S. military intervention in Vietnam unless it was multilateral, unless there was an international coalition. And Secretary of State John Foster Dulles couldn't convince enough U.S. allies to assist. So after the partition of Vietnam in 1954, the Geneva Accords, President Eisenhower supported the establishment of a non-communist government in the Republic of Vietnam and supported its first president, Ngo Dinh Diem. Now, Eisenhower considered this to be a victory kind of on par with Korea in that the partition of Vietnam meant that the balance of power between the communist and the non-communist sphere, the two orbits, remained. The balance of power remained. So in a way, this was somewhat of a victory. President Kennedy was very concerned with American credibility. Even before he was president, as a congressman from Massachusetts, he argued that if the U.S. did not act aggressively to protect free, what he was referring to as free nations in Asia, that China would eventually come in to dominate the region. This is before Kennedy's president. So he's got this mindset even before he's president. But he believed that the old ways of European imperialism were wise. You don't just go in and plant a flag and establish political control. That in order to prevent, in order to contain communism, the U.S. has to try to develop non-communist native governments. That popular local leaders are key. Okay, popular local leaders are key. And there's a model, there was a model for this in the Philippines. So in the Philippines, Colonel Edward Lansdale went to the Philippines and identified and groomed a man by the name of Ramon Magsaysay to eventually become the president of the Philippines. And this provided a type of model for America that American policymakers thought that perhaps they could implement elsewhere. And so you see the image here is Lansdale and Magsaysay, and then this is, you actually see Eisenhower and Ngo Dinh Diem in the other image. In 1956, Kennedy said this. He said, Vietnam represents the cornerstone of the free world in Southeast Asia. And this idea informed his foreign policy worldview as president. Vietnam represents the cornerstone of the free world in Southeast Asia. You probably know this quote from his inaugural address. Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, in order to assure the survival and the success of liberty. Kennedy used a rhetoric of idealism to try and convince the American public that the U.S. had a moral responsibility to help governments and political movements resist what he saw as communist aggression. So the U.S. has a moral responsibility. This is Kennedy's portrayal to the American public of why the U.S. should be involved in Vietnam, that the U.S. has a moral responsibility to help governments and political movements resist what, again, what he is calling communist aggression. Now, historians are also still debating what Kennedy would have done had he lived beyond November of 1963. What would he have done? And part of the reason why this is another question that's still up for debate is that while Kennedy in public was very staunchly anti-communist and very staunchly moralistic in terms of American responsibility to prevent communist aggression, help what he's referring to as free world nations, in public he seems very committed to this. In private, he did express reservations about the ability of South Vietnam to survive, to thrive. And he expressed reservations about whether South Vietnam was worth U.S. investment. So because we know that he had those reservations, historians are still debating what would he have done. I mean, and this is, of course, all counterfactual, because we probably will never really know for sure what he would have done. People who knew him, who worked closely with him, members of his administration, they're also divided. Some have said that he would have escalated as Johnson did. Others have said that he would have pulled back. Again, we probably will never know for sure. But historians like to debate this. What would Kennedy have done? Because really, I mean, we're kind of at a turning point in Kennedy's administration where we could see there are moments where the U.S. could pull back from this in ways that it would have been much harder to do as Johnson escalated further. So I think probably we will still continue to debate what would Kennedy have done in Vietnam. Also interesting on that issue, interesting to see the opinions of some rhetoric scholars who have studied Kennedy's speeches. Some have argued that what Kennedy actually thought about Vietnam was to a certain degree irrelevant because of the public pronouncements he had made that were so idealistic. It would have been hard for him to make a policy reversal. And this is what some rhetoric scholars who have studied Kennedy's speeches have said, that he was so ideological in his public language, he's talking in these moralistic terms, that it would have been difficult for him to make a major policy reversal without ramifications regarding his own credibility. So he's saying the U.S., we have this moral responsibility. This is what we do. This is why we do it. We have this great calling. To then come back and say, actually, we don't have this moral responsibility. Some rhetoric scholars have argued that his public words, and can public words in general take on a life of their own after they're out of the mouths of the speakers, to where it then no longer matters what the speaker actually thinks, because the words are out there and the public has now consumed these messages and these ideas. And so it would be difficult to backpedal when you have been so idealistic and so moralistic. So again, just kind of interesting to think about and to talk about Kennedy's speeches and the ideas that he's giving to the public, and if those ideas actually make it more difficult for him to backpedal or to change course in his policy on Vietnam. What the American public would have done, how they would have received a policy reversal after being given all these very inspiring pronouncements about American duty to the world, or to the free world, as he would have said. Lyndon Johnson was also very concerned with American credibility. He subscribed to the domino theory as well. The idea that if South Vietnam becomes the next, and he looked at it this way, victim of communist aggression, then that would just start a ripple effect that would be felt throughout Southeast Asia and throughout the Asia-Pacific world. And Johnson believed that if the U.S. didn't help South Vietnam, didn't, again, demonstrate a commitment to helping South Vietnam, that it would send a message to the rest of Southeast Asia and to other U.S. allies in the region that the U.S. was not truly committed to containing communism, that all of these lofty pronouncements were just words. So we have to put something behind those words. Johnson believed this too. Johnson and members of his administration, especially people like Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara, were talking publicly about the strategic importance of South Vietnam and talking about American credibility. So McNamara, in March of 1964, said, "To defend Southeast Asia, we must meet the challenge in South Vietnam." So he's putting it in regional terms, that this isn't just about the U.S. and Vietnam, but it's about broader regional issues in Southeast Asia. To defend Southeast Asia, we must meet the challenge in South Vietnam. McNamara also argued that Southeast Asia was of strategic importance to the U.S. because of its central location between India and Australia, New Zealand, and the Philippines. So he's trying to make an argument for the strategic importance of Vietnam. This is another quote from McNamara. He said, "In communist hands, this area would pose a most serious threat to the security of the United States and to the family of free world nations." Now, with hindsight, we can debate whether that was actually true. But at the time, again, thinking about these decision makers in the context of their time and the issues that they, as they understood them at the time, is important for our understanding and kind of teaching our students how to understand why these types of decisions are made. That as much as we can, if we step out of our 21st century context with all of the benefits of hindsight that we have, and try to understand the context of the time, the local conditions, the concerns of U.S. allies in Southeast Asia, this rhetoric about Southeast Asia being of strategic importance to the U.S., to think about all of these statements in the context of their time. McNamara argued that if Hanoi won the war, if Vietnam was unified under Hanoi's leadership, it would just be one step closer to Chinese control of Vietnam and then all of Southeast Asia. And therefore, the U.S. had to use Vietnam as a test case to prove that the free world could cope with communist wars of liberation, which were hallmarks of decolonization, that the free world could handle this. This is happening elsewhere. This is happening elsewhere in the decolonizing world. So we could use Vietnam to prove that the so-called free world knows how to deal with this. This is happening elsewhere. This is a hallmark of decolonization, that if we could use Vietnam to prove that we can cope with communist wars of liberation. Now, one of the problems for Johnson is that he actually wasn't fully committed to the idea of sending U.S. troops to do this. So Johnson is early on thinking about how the U.S. can support the South Vietnamese military So the Army of the Republic of South Vietnam, the Army of the Republic of Vietnam, ARVN, other branches of the South Vietnamese military, that the U.S. should provide financial aid, should provide advisory support. But Johnson was tentative on his whether the U.S. should send troops. He believed that the South Vietnamese should be fighting this fight with American assistance, financially and on an advisory level. But in 1964, 65, 66, political instability in Saigon, issues related to China and the Soviet Union in North Vietnam, Hanoi's refusal to agree to remove troops and stop aiding the National Liberation Front in South Vietnam, all of these issues contributed to Johnson's decisions to escalate U.S. military commitment in South Vietnam. Now, in September of 1967, Nguyen Van Thieu was elected president of South Vietnam. And we can see that a very small moment of perhaps some potential for stability in South Vietnam, But then January 1968, and the Tet Offensive happens, turn Americans, widespread American opposition to the war now, turns American public opinion against the war, and influenced Johnson's decision to not seek re-election. So again, counterfactual, we can wonder, what might have happened? Johnson chooses to not seek re-election. And that opens the door for Richard Nixon to come in as president into a context that's very different from the contexts of Truman, Eisenhower, Kennedy, and Johnson. There's domestic opposition to the war. In fact, we know that one of the points that Nixon ran on in 1968 was he's going to be part of ending the conflict. We're not talking about engagement, escalation. This is about ending the war now. So there's domestic opposition to the war. Internationally, there's detente, the lessening of tensions between the U.S. and the Soviet Union. Nixon's visit to China. These are changing conditions surrounding Vietnam that made what was happening there seem maybe, I don't know that less important is the right way to put it, maybe less dire or less pressing than they had appeared in 1954 or 1965. So I mention this to say that, to kind of drive home the idea that that international and regional contexts matter. International and regional contexts matter to U.S. decision making regarding military intervention and war in Vietnam. So to just sum up, and then I'll open it up to questions. It's difficult to identify one starting point for why did the U.S. get in, or when the U.S. got involved in Vietnam. Why did the U.S. get involved in Vietnam? It's difficult to identify one starting point because really U.S. intervention in Vietnam was a gradual process. A gradual process that, as I've mentioned, involved economic aid, diplomacy, politics, even presidential personalities, and of course, military force. It's a gradual process of kind of going to war in Vietnam. And then, of course, we have the three factors that unified these gradual moments of U.S. intervention in South Vietnam. The regional alliances in Southeast Asia and concerns about the spread of communism. The superpower tensions between the U.S., the Soviet Union, and China. And the idea that the U.S. was actually committed, proving that the U.S. was actually committed to stopping the spread of communism, putting an action behind those words and demonstrating U.S. credibility. All of these factors contributed to those gradual decisions that led the U.S. to go to war in Vietnam. Thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions that you might have.
Arthur?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think we saw you first.
Okay. Here we go. Mark Yonaway, Wimogo High School, Litchfield, Connecticut. Could you comment on three books for me? Harry Summers, H.R. McMaster's, and Stanley Karnow.
Maybe can you ask me?
What do you think of them? What do you think of their arguments? What do you, are they valuable?
Yeah, you know, I think they're absolutely valuable in part because one of the things that's interesting about the writings on the Vietnam War is that they, and I think we could see this in many different conflicts, but they reflect mindsets, political opinions of scholars, and can demonstrate the politicized nature of the doing of history. And this is another thing that I talk about with my students is kind of the politics of doing history, the politics of writing history, that with the Vietnam War, I think in part because it's fairly recent and much of it has been written by participants, so whether military, civilian, journalists, we can see the political mindsets of the writers as much as we see the events. And I think we're moving into a wave of scholarship where many of the authors are in ways less connected to the war, and so maybe to take a more dispassionate approach to the conflict. So I just kind of bring the three of them together. I think that they reflect as much about the writers as about the conflict.
A marvelous presentation. You covered a tremendous amount of ground in a very short period of time, except you omitted the decision that many historians think was the most important of all. You know what I'm talking about. The overthrow of Ngoc Dinh Diem.
Yeah.
The green light given by the Kennedy administration to the generals in Saigon to murder Diem. They didn't expect him to be murdered, but he was murdered, and plus the murder of his brother, and the event that threw South Vietnamese politics into the complete chaos that Diem himself had warned against.
Right.
And that there's another argument that the overthrow of Diem is the proof, the implicit proof that the Kennedy administration wasn't going to pull out of South Vietnam because the overthrow of Diem was a war measure.
Right. Yeah, thank you. Absolutely. That is a major moment because there have been some books written about Ngo Dinh Diem in the last couple of years using Vietnamese sources that demonstrate that he had a well-articulated plan for building a nation that maybe didn't look like a perfect democracy to start. So Kennedy and some of his advisors were concerned, for example, about the relationship between Ngo Dinh Diem and his administration and the Buddhist opposition, you know, and some of those other internal issues. But Ngo Dinh Diem had a plan and was well connected with Americans, but the problem for many Americans was that Ngo Dinh Diem also wanted to distance himself and actually build his own nation without so much American heavy-handed involvement. And I think that speaks to a larger issue of U.S. intervention and U.S. efforts to assist nation building, is the U.S.'s struggle to find a balance between providing assistance on an advisory level and then also letting those popular or established or local leaders actually build a nation. So yes, I thank you for mentioning that. I agree that is that the green light to assassinate Ngo Dinh Diem was a major point in the process of U.S. intervention, and as Dr. McDougall rightly pointed out, set into motion the chaos in Saigon that existed really until late 1967. So yeah, thank you for adding that point.
Just to follow up on Walter's point, you mentioned the American decision to escalate. In fact, the American escalation is a response to the North Vietnamese response to the assassination of dim because they can't believe that we've screwed up so badly. Mm-hmm. And South Vietnam is now in chaos. So they create an entirely new army division, the 9th Division.
Right.
And they say, now we can really go for it. And they start sending hundreds of thousands of people into South Vietnam, which is something they hadn't been doing before. So this is an excellent talk, and I know that it's about America, but there is a very, very complex reciprocity between what North Vietnam does and how we react, and that is only beginning to be understood. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. That is absolutely, and again, I think that is it speaks to the idea that we have to think about this regionally, and we have to think about the decisions and the actions made by North Vietnam. That the U.S. and South Vietnam were responding to northern invasion and also northern support for the National Liberation Front. Yes, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you for adding that.
Thank you again, echoing Walter, for a very fine presentation. I didn't hear, but all of the first question, but building on that, what sources did you find particularly worthwhile among the endless books and articles and oral histories now about the war? And especially, did you find the work of Bernard Fall or H.R. McMaster at all useful? The latter is, of course, now our U.S. National Security Advisor. His book, Dereliction of Duty, with 2020 hindsight, is a ferocious indictment of the Johnson administration, the Kennedy administration, especially his predecessors in the U.S. Army.
Thank you. There have been a number of books, like I mentioned, written recently using Vietnamese sources, and I have also done research in Vietnamese archives. I'm going to give you a couple of titles. Misalliance by Edward Miller is about Nguyen Anh Diem. It's based on research in Vietnamese archival sources. And it tells the story of his plans for building a South Vietnamese nation and the U.S. engagement with that. So I highly recommend Misalliance by Edward Miller. Also, Hanoi's War by Linh Hang Nguyen. Nguyen is N-G-U-Y-E-N. N-G-U-Y-E-N. Hanoi's War. Also based on Vietnamese archival sources, but from the perspective of the North. And so she demonstrates the Northern plans for invasion, Northern war-making plans. Another book that looks at the Northern perspective, but also demonstrates the kind of Northern agency in kind of, I don't know, we could use the word proactive or aggressive, depending on how we want to look at it. The author is Pierre Asselin, Asselin. Hanoi's Road to War. I'm blanking on the title. I believe it's Hanoi's Road to War. And then his other book is called A Bitter Peace, which, again, using Vietnamese archival sources, demonstrates Hanoi decision making that had an impact on U.S. and South Vietnamese decision making. So the trend in the scholarship is really going towards Vietnamese perspectives and doing research in Vietnamese sources, if you can develop the language skills and get into the archives. Because so much has been written about the U.S. perspectives. I mean, I think there's still more to be done. So much has been written on U.S. perspectives. But the turn in the scholarship is really going toward trying to incorporate Vietnamese perspectives to give us a more fuller picture of the story. And really, it will complicate our understandings of American intervention as well.
Thanks. Thank you. Javier Irigueta from Wilmington Friends School. I wonder if you could comment on the very influential documentary made by Robert McNamara about his entire involvement, not only in the Vietnam War, but the lead up coming from World War II, and in particular also about his reflections about the advisability of when the United States is considering going into war. He proposes as a rule that we should always look for agreement from our allies as a condition of doing so, which I thought was quite striking in light of, several of our other interventions.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting to see policymakers, presidents, looking, reflecting back, you know, again, with the benefit of hindsight. So I think that's a, it's a good documentary to see him thinking and talking about some of those issues. I mean, the issue of getting support from alliance, from allies, you know, we could argue about, regarding the Vietnam War, whether the U.S. actually did that. The U.S. did have, there were allied troops in South Vietnam, South Korean troops, there were Australian, New Zealand troops, but there was also resistance by European allies to U.S. involvement in Vietnam. And so I think that documentary is good for just kind of grappling with some of those issues and maybe, you know, reading his words from the time and then pairing that from a teaching perspective and then pairing that with his reflections afterwards and seeing where there are disconnects, seeing where there are ways in which he is justifying what he, decisions that he was part of making. So.
Chris Hughes, the Stanwich School. How autonomous was North Vietnam and how influenced was it by the Soviets and the Chinese over the course of the war?
Yeah, that's a great question. North Vietnam, like South Vietnam, wanted to be autonomous, but they both were very influenced by their respective, I guess we'd say respective superpower allies. As I mentioned, Hanoi knew what it was receiving from the Soviet Union, from China, in terms of military and financial aid. Hanoi also knew the benefits, trade-wise, of being able to be part of trade with Eastern Europe. And so Hanoi tried to resist and put some distance and have agency, just as Saigon did. But it was guided by the Soviet Union and China in many of the same ways that South Vietnam was by the U.S.
One of the things that I can't answer is how much good intelligence we had about what was going on in Hanoi, and particularly the factional struggles, the role of Lê Duẩn, things like that. Mm-hmm. In your research, have you gotten any sense that either we didn't have any good intelligence or that we did have good intelligence but we weren't using it?
Yeah, that's a good question, and it's hard to say. The book that I mentioned, Hanoi's War, deals a little bit with that. I agree. I think that's a hard question to answer. I don't know how good the intelligence was. I mean, there was an awareness, but I also think that there was the knowledge of the role of Lê Duẩn was not as prominent as a sense of understanding that Ho Chi Minh was the one, even though he wasn't. So I think there was still an attitude that this is the person, even though the reality was that Lê Duẩn in the South for sure was kind of guiding things.
Good morning. Jim Feldman, Lakeshore Schools in Michigan. I had a question about some of our allies in South Vietnam. We really know very little about our allies. The Koreans did have a large presence and did suffer a lot of casualties. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you could comment on some of our other allies besides the South Vietnamese, the Australians, the New Zealanders, and things like that.
Yeah, that's actually an area that is ripe for more study. There's a book. I'm not remembering the title fully, but it's Lyndon Johnson's More Flags program that deals with the Allied effort in South Vietnam. But I think that is an area of more study. I can't tell you numbers on casualties or anything like that. I do know that Australia had a I think the largest presence of any ally in South Vietnam. But yeah, definitely an area for more study.
It's sort of a follow-up. Was there protest movements in those countries similar to protest movements in our country?
I know in Australia there was. I don't know about say, for example, South Korea, but there definitely was in Australia. So again, I think looking at the domestic experience of the Vietnam War by allies of the United States is an area where scholars, future scholars, can make an impact. I think that's a good question.
The South Koreans kept about 50,000 troops. throughout our main engagement in Southeast Asia, which means they had about as many combat troops as we did. Only 10% of the U.S. Army then and now is combat troops. They developed a ferocious and well-deserved reputation for remorseless, ruthless, and brutal combat, and were generally avoided by the enemy for that reason. The Australians had more or less about 1,600 annually, and the New Zealanders a few hundred. Both of those allies suffered considerably, and the same kind of anti-war sentiment translated into anti-military sentiment there as here.
Thank you.
I have a follow-up just on those last two comments. Were South Korea and Australia involved because of their CETO obligations, or were there other kind of alliances that brought them in?
I'm not sure on the answer to that. I apologize. I'm not sure on the answer to that.
I really appreciate that you talked a lot about here and there, how you present things to your students or what you try to encourage them to do. And so I was just wondering if there are certain models that maybe we could bring back to talk about either building consensus toward war here, although it seems awfully rushed and doesn't seem like there's a huge referendum on it. And 64, 68, it seems like it's 68, it's voted, you know, they vote in a person that is opposed to the war and it's going to end the war, and he doesn't. But just ways of thinking about how consensus is built and how it breaks apart, and then how consensus builds sort of against the war.
Yeah, that's a great question. And you know, that's where you can bring in the kind of international context of the superpower rivalries and communism and how those messages are portrayed to the U.S. public. You know, if Americans are being told we're under threat by the Soviet Union, there is a potential that there might be a nuclear bomb dropped on us. If more countries become communist, then the threat is going to be stronger. American citizens are hearing this message, then are they contacting their congressional representatives? Is that playing into congressional decisions about war making? Are presidents aware of the messages that citizens are hearing? And if they are they responding? I mean, I think that would be a really interesting way to engage students in a discussion about political decision making and the role of public opinion, which is relevant to, you know, to current context, to really any context. So I think that might be an interesting way to do is put it in the context of the Cold War and what American citizens understood about the Cold War, and how those messages, which tend to be pretty simplistic, how those messages shaped what Americans understood about the Vietnam War.
It just seems so helpful, and I'd love to ask any of the panel, or even by the end of the day, is public opinion at all of any importance to these people? Decisions about going to war.
I believe that it is.
Okay.
You know, the turn against the war in 68 as a result of the Tet Offensive was one of the things that led Johnson to not seek re-election, and that led Nixon to run for the presidency with a platform that in part talked about ending the war. And you know, because there was an anti-war movement before that, but it was fairly small until 1968, when you had a kind of a broad consensus across the political spectrum by Americans that this is enough. Whether I'm Republican, Democrat, this is enough. And so, yes, I believe that public opinion definitely had an impact on decision making, especially in 1968 and after.
I'm glad you mentioned the anti-war movement. My father served in Vietnam in 66 and 67, and for 50 years now, he's been a very deeply wounded man from what he's experienced there, but he's also just very bitter and resentful mm-hmm. of the treatment of Vietnam veterans. And I'm wondering if you can speak to, is this wholly unique, or are there other wars where veterans feel similarly, and does the start of the war and the complexities of the start contribute directly to that?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think World War I is an interesting comparison point where, while there wasn't an anti-war movement in the U.S. on the scale of the Vietnam War the anti-Vietnam War movement, there were things like, there was draft resistance, for example, in World War I. And then World War I veterans came back and they marched and demanded benefits that they had been told they were going to receive and then weren't receiving. You know, and World War I wasn't the kind of a triumphant moment that World War II, at least the way we have remembered it, was for Americans. It was during World War I that kind of judicial decisions like the Clear and Present Danger Act, the notion that the federal government can crack down on freedom of speech, civil liberties, if that speech could potentially undermine a war effort, and I think, you know, the public reception of that was mixed, and so I think a comparison to World War I is really interesting. I also think it's interesting to think about how Americans have tried to maybe make right the treatment of Vietnam veterans. So that now, I know that the Defense Department has a series of kind of Vietnam 50th anniversary remembrances that are going on now through 2025, the 50th anniversary of the fall of Saigon. And a lot of the emphasis is on veterans and the experience of Vietnam veterans. And I think that on some level, there is a sense of maybe guilt about the ways in which U.S. Or Vietnam veterans were treated when they came back, either in that they were actively yelled at, the stories of veterans being spat upon, you know, those sorts of things, or they were ignored. I've interviewed a lot of Vietnam veterans, and the most common story that I get is a story of coming home from having served and nobody wants to talk about it. So it's not that they were yelled at or anyone treated them badly, but nobody wanted to hear about it. They wanted them to settle back into a normal life. The Vietnam War was a shocking event. Let's forget about it. And so veterans talk about how, so I held in for 30 years, you know, what I had seen, what I had done, until one day I woke up and I couldn't stop crying, and then I finally got help. So I think there is, you know, what you're describing with your father, I've heard about that. I've heard that story from a lot of veterans I've interviewed.
Hi, David Lonborg, New York City. I have two questions, kind of following up on the previous comments. To what extent has the fact that we essentially lost in Vietnam affected the way in which we perceive the war? The other question is, to what extent has the media coverage and the way how the media covered the war then and now also affected the way in which the war has been perceived, particularly for generations like me who grew up after the war had already ended?
Yeah, thank you. Those are great questions. The idea or the idea of the U.S. having lost the war, that definitely, you know, the winners write the history. I mean, then that is true, and I think that fact has shaped the coverage. I think what has also shaped the coverage is that, and this came up in one of the talks yesterday. I think it was David Silby's regarding the writing about the Spanish-American War was really writing about Vietnam. The Vietnam War has kind of been held up as the example of bad U.S. Cold War policy decisions, has kind of been set up as the example of American hubris in the world, you know, all those sorts of things. And so that political attitude has also shaped how the war has been written. Like I mentioned earlier, that the politics of writing history, that it's those who've been writing the war have been participants, and in many cases, the writings by academic historians, really up until, say, maybe the last 10 to 15 years, many of those academic historians were involved in the anti-war movement, and so there's definitely kind of a political bent to why they're writing about the Vietnam War, so to use that as a way to critique U.S. foreign policy in larger ways. In terms of the media, there's a lot of debate over what role the media had in the U.S. losing the war and policy changes. I think where I can say that the media had an impact is I can say that the media had an impact on public opinion. You know, historians of the media role in Americans' understandings of the Vietnam War talk about this being the first conflict or the first war where Americans are seeing it every night on TV. So they're seeing the carnage. They're seeing interviews with troops coming back from a battle where many men have died. You know, they're seeing the, they're seeing these stories about body counts, but yet the war isn't winning. And so I think maybe more than media coverage is media technology had an impact on public opinion because of the immediacy of the coverage, what at that time seemed like immediacy. So, thank you.
Could you address how the shootings at Kent State and the bayonettings at the University of New Mexico might have affected public opinion?
Yeah, and again, that also speaks to coverage. The U.S. had already made the decision to pull out of Vietnam, but in terms of American public's belief in the presidency, belief in the truthfulness of what policymakers are telling the citizenry, I think in that way, Kent State had a major impact in terms of Americans being like, we can't trust our policymakers because we're being told we're not being told what's actually happening. And the Kent State shootings brought that out for sure. It was part of the coming out of that.
Yeah, I had a comment about your comment about writing about the war, you know, from the current perspective as a former Vietnam War protester. I've spent a lot of time over the years with Walter McDougall, who was a Vietnam veteran, talking about the war. I think serious historians and serious academics, regardless of, you know, what they were doing during the war, there's not a dramatic disagreement about the failures of it, about the things that went wrong, the things, you know, and so forth. I think some of the other writings are, you know, disingenuous. Some of the former people who protested with me who wrote about how successful the protest movement was, and I go, really? 10 years? 10-year war? Successful? But, you know, so I just thought I'd add that.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I agree with you that there is that consensus about Vietnam, even from differing political sides.
The other ironic thing I thought was that one of the demonstrations where I got in the most trouble was in 1969, and it was against the use of Agent Orange specifically. It had to do with recruiting for chemical companies. And 20 years later, it was Vietnam veterans who were getting arrested in protest for the government not willing to treat the veterans for their illnesses from Agent Orange.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
So the media question inspired me to ask a comparison of media then and media now. I mean, we had a very long war then, mm-hmm. and I remember watching TV then and seeing it on the news. And we have a very war now, and I watch TV now, and I don't see it on the news.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think we saw more coverage 2003, 2004, 2005. We're seeing less coverage now. Why that is, I'm not entirely sure. I wonder if with 24-hour news cycle, the internet, you know, everything from the New York Times to blogs, if there's almost so much saturation that the coverage is less powerful. Because there's so much, but I mean, I see what you're saying about why is there not so much coverage about what we're doing in Afghanistan now. I don't know. I don't have an answer to that. I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for your questions.